Guns Against FBS opponents help pay the bills at places like USD, but they also provide the student athletes with some pretty incredible experiences. How's everybody doing? I'm Jay Elson, and this is Coyote Corner. South Dakota has played at places like Oregon, Northwestern, and Wisconsin. And who could forget TCF Bank Stadium, where the Coyotes upset Minnesota in 2010 for their lone win over an FBS opponent. Saturday, Joe Glenn and the Yotes looked to recapture that magic in Manhattan as they kicked off the 2015 season against Bill Snyder and the Kansas State Wildcats. The Wildcats were fired up, though, as were the rest of the nearly 54,000 in attendance, the 21st consecutive sellout at Bill Snyder Family Stadium. The place was loud then, but it really got loud right here. Morgan Burns takes the opening kickoff 3 yards deep in the end zone, and he is gone. Miles Bergner, the only Kyle to even make contact, as Burns takes it back officially 100 yards for the touchdown. Just like that, it's 7-0 Wildcats. Later in the first, Bergner hoping to get 3 of those points back, but he pulls the 42-yard attempt wide left. He had missed from 55 earlier, so Miles starts the season 0-for-2 after missing just once in all of 2014. Ensuing possession, K-State's offense starts to get things going. Joe Huebner looking for Cody Cook. Great catch, 35 yards, which proved to be the longest play of the day for the Wildcats. 7 snaps later, Huebner trying to finish off the drive, but Ryan Hillier foils that plan. He strips it away before Huebner can break the plane. Andrew Van Ginkle recovers for USD, and the Coyote fans rejoice. Second quarter now, 10-0 Wildcats, and they're looking for more. Big hole for Justin Sillman. Picks up 18 of his 51 yards on the day. KSU marches 45 yards. In 5 plays, capping it off with this 2-yard touchdown from Winston Dimmel, 17-0 Kansas State. A few minutes later, special teams would hurt the Coyotes yet again. Eric Schufer trying to make something happen on the punt return, but Munchie wishes he had this one back, loses the football, and KSU recovers at the USD 24. That led to this. Huebner to the corner for Deontay Burton, 24-yard scoring strike. And it's 24-0 Wildcats. The Coyotes would try and answer before the half. Ryan Sager with a strike to Brant Van Roekel. 26 yards to the Kansas State 34. Van Roekel finished with 4 catches and 56 yards for the game. But the drive would stall from there. On 3rd and 9, Sager is dropped by Marquell Bryant. First of 2 sacks in the night for that KSU defense. Coyotes would go to the half trailing 24-0. And end up falling to Kansas State by a count of 34-0. Sager with some solid numbers in defeat. He completes 60% of his passes for 205 yards, no touchdowns, and no interceptions. Schuford led USD with 6 catches for 79 yards. Defensively, Jacob Warner finished with a team-high 8 tackles. Tyson Graham had a nice game as well. So despite the final score, USD saw some good things and positive signs on both sides of the football.
It was no different for us. We were just going to try to play as hard as we could, and regardless of what the score was, regardless of what they were doing, regardless of what happens on special teams or defense, we got to play our own game and stay in our system. And I thought offensively we did a pretty good job. Obviously, we got some things to work on, but we fought hard, and that's all you can ask for.
I feel like our defense can be proud of how we played today. I feel like there was nothing I was ashamed of. There was nothing that, you know, poor effort plays. There was nothing like that. It was a solid game for us, and we're going to take it as a, you know, building experience.
It all started with our front 7. You know, we got some pressure on the quarterback, made him use his feet. Our linebackers fit their gap, which made our job easier, and everything just started clicking. So I'm excited for what's going to happen next week, now that we got that first week under our belt.
As we said, the Coyotes did find a few things to build on in Manhattan, and we'll reflect on those and the rest of the 2015 season opener with head coach Joe Glenn next.
Coyote Corner on Midco Sports Network is presented by Dakota Land Honda.
And welcome back to Coyote Corner. Jay Elson joined down here at the Dakota Dome by head coach of the University of South Dakota, Joe Glenn. And Joe, you get the season started on Saturday evening in Manhattan, Kansas, at Bill Snyder Family Stadium against a Kansas State team that was pretty tough. 34-0 the final in that game, and we'll cover all of it here, but the start of the game certainly didn't go the way that you guys had hoped as they rip off a 100-yard kickoff return to start your season.
Well, I don't think all 53,000 people of the sellout crowd had sat down yet when we kicked off, and they took it back 103 yards. So we can't start like that. We had quite a few new guys, and unfortunately, one guy rotated the wrong way, and another guy rotated opposite him and left a gap, and that's all they needed. They hit the crease, and the guy had buku speed, and away he went.
And that made it 7-0 early, and unfortunately, it set a bit of a tone for you in the first half in terms of special teams. Those were an issue throughout that opening 30 minutes. Some sort of miscue on special teams led to all 24 of their first half points.
Well, the kickoff return, then we shanked a punt, and then they had a punt return that took us down deep in our own territory. So, that's something. We've got a new coordinator. He's trying to push the button on the right guys, and we worked real hard on it, and we're a little bit disappointed, but these are the guys we got. We'll work with it. We'll get better, and as they learn our new stuff, and I think we'll be fine.
Maybe the good part is, too, that now you have some film to point to and say, this
sure
is what we're talking about,
right,
fellas.
It's hard to go full speed on kickoff, cover, kickoff return, because you're running, 70, 80, 90 yards every time. Mm-hmm. So you try and do it part and parcel and break it up into segments.
Sure.
And you never quite know until you kick one off in the real game what's going to happen.
Let's take a look at the offense now. You were able to move the ball at times in this football game, but K-State made you earn most of that through the air. They weren't giving you much on the ground, and a lot of the credit goes to the guys up front for them in that regard.
I think we're pretty much together on the fact that this is the best – or one of the best teams we faced defensively since we've been here. And I give a lot of the credit to those guys. We've had a good camp as far as run. We've got tough guys and good running backs. We've got some new speed that we thought we might be able to do some things running the football, but they were just able to shake us down pretty good, and we never did break off anything much worthy of big yards.
Yeah, I think the three running backs averaged about 2 yards per carry.
Right.
But I thought credit to you and your staff is that you didn't shy away from it. You continued to try and run the football throughout because, as you said afterward, that's what we're going to need to do to win football games.
Right. We were outmanned, I would say, a little bit, but that's kind of our DNA. If we're going to have a football team this year that's worthy, we're going to run the football and pass it. And kind of scratch where it itches, but we've got to be able to run the football better than that. We missed a couple holes that, they're not beautiful holes, but when you got a crease, you got to go get, 4, 5, or 6. And we just, you can't miss two. A couple running backs miss two. He misses one, he misses two. Mm-hmm. And you got five of them are on, the guy's not hitting the right spot. And
sure,
we're better than that. So we'll keep working on it and see if we can get better.
In the face of that, in being one-dimensional, I thought Ryan Sager was able to put together a pretty solid day. Could you assess his performance?
Yeah, he did a nice job. He guarded the football. He threw for 200-plus yards. He completed 60% of his passes. No passes were intercepted. He did a nice job, I think, in light of the fact that we didn't score a touchdown or make a field goal. But, I'm real happy. I think all of us are happy with Ryan Sager, and I think he's just going to get better and better with each rep.
Let's go to the defensive side of things now. We got our first look at that 4-3 in motion, and I thought this group really showed some flashes on Saturday. One of the main goals with this whole change was to get better against the run, and while K-State did put up 185 yards on the ground, they did not break the big one. I think their longest run all day was 16 yards or something like that, and their average 4.6 yards per carry is a full yard less than what teams were able to get against you last year. So were you encouraged by your ability to slow down that running game at K-State?
Well, we have to be. This is a Big 12 opponent, and I know this was last year, but most of these guys, their whole line was back, minus one guy. They've been good at rushing the football, and for us to hang in there pretty much toe-to-toe for most of the game is certainly a feather in our hat.
Absolutely. Well, in the end, Joe, I think it's not the result you wanted, but I think there's some things to build on there. Looking forward already to moving up this next week, taking on UC Davis team out there in California. Thanks for your time for this week, Joe. And now that we have heard from the head coach, our own Andre Fields is going to weigh in on Saturday's season opener. We're going to cover Saturday's storylines when we come back.
Coyote Corner on Midco Sports Network is presented by Dakota Land Honda.
And welcome back. Well, there's plenty to talk about following the Coyotes' season opening loss at Kansas State. Some good, some not so good. And here to weigh in on all of it is former USD defensive back and current Midco SN analyst Andre Fields. Andre, time for Saturday storylines. And we've got to start with special teams. USD spent so much time on this phase of the game in the offseason. They worked on fundamentals. They worked on assignments and execution. So it had to be frustrating to see things go wrong on Saturday the way they did. Before we get your take on that, though, let's hear what the team's new special teams coordinator, Marquise Williams, had to say about that group's struggles.
It wasn't nothing, you know, that they out-schemed us or did anything special. It's just more so our guys being able to execute their assignments on a consistent basis and, you know, showing that, you know, if you don't execute your assignment, this is the outcome that will happen. So, again, it's a growing pain for us, and we'll get through it and be able to watch it on Monday and learn from those mistakes.
Well, Andre, one of the things Marquise equated this all to was a parenting thing. He says when you tell your kids, don't touch the fire. If you touch the fire, you're going to get burned. His guys touched the fire. They got burned on Saturday.
Yeah, that's what it looked like. They got burned in a bunch of different phases of special teams. But I think the main thing going forward is that they can learn from this. This was an opportunity for them to learn everything that they've put together, bring it out onto the field, and showcase it. But it looked as if they were doing too much thinking rather than reacting. But as they get more practice time and all of these different techniques, I think they're going to get much better.
He also said that all the things he's been trying to teach him, all the things that he's been telling him, hey, don't do this. If you do this, this is going to be what happens. And now he's got film to go and back him up.
Yeah, and that's the main thing as a coach. You can go back and say, see, didn't I tell you don't do it this way, do it that way? This is why, and they can't deny it. They're going to have to go out and do exactly what coach said.
The film doesn't lie. All right, well, one of the big curiosities coming into this game was how Ryan Sager was going to handle things, being that this was the first time he was coming into the season as the starter. The answer was pretty well. Sager completed 60% of his passes for 205 yards. He showed poise under pressure, and he made sound decisions. And there's not much more you can ask out of your quarterback than that.
No, it isn't. And I think the one big key is here, the moment wasn't too big for him. We didn't expect it to be. I mean, this is a guy who came in after a starter went down at Oregon, of all places. So we didn't think it was going to be too big, and he handled it perfectly, in my opinion. No picks, 18 for 30, over 205 yards. And this was in an offense that was completely one-dimensional. Mm-hmm. He didn't try to force things. He made it all work for him. I think this is a very positive sign, not just for the offense, but for the whole team.
Yeah, funny you should mention that. The Coyotes obviously hoping for big things out of Sager in the passing game, but Joe Glenn has made no bones about it. The Coyotes are a run-first team, and they just could not get things going on the ground. Just 61 yards rushing on the day. The three running backs, Trevor Bauma, Michael Frederick, and Nate Gunn, averaged barely 2 yards per carry. And, of course, Kansas State deserves a lot of the credit for that. But I think we can agree if USD is going to be successful this year, they're going to have to get better in this department.
Yeah, they have to. I mean, this is the Missouri Valley Football Conference. You're going to have to be able to run. But as you said, I think a lot of this will come along. We were playing a Big 12 defense that not only is looking to play in a major bowl game, but they have sights on playoffs and things like that, too.
Absolutely. Well, finally, on the defensive side of things, I thought the Coyotes graded out pretty well, actually, especially in the red zone. Kansas State took it inside the USD 25 times, but managed just 2 touchdowns, and the coaches are going to take those results anytime they can get them, won't they?
Absolutely. I mean, you get a Big 12 team, but 5 times in the red zone, you come away with only 2 touchdowns. Think about it. After the first quarter, it's 7-0, and that's on the opening kickoff return. Lots of positives to build off there for USD's defense.
Yep. Not the result the team wanted, but certainly things to build on going forward. All right, thanks to you, Dre, for that. And the road trip continues this weekend for the Coyotes as they head west for a date with UC Davis. We're going to preview the matchup with the Aggies after this.
Coyote Corner on Midco Sports Network is presented by Dakota Land Honda.
With Kansas State now behind them, the Coyotes are turning their attention to their first FCS test of the season, which will take place Saturday at UC Davis. And for more on the Aggies, we bring in Scott Marsh, who handles the play-by-play duties for 1140 KHTK Radio
in Sacramento. Thanks for joining us, Scott. We are talking here about two programs, South Dakota and UC Davis, that are in very similar spots. The teams walked nearly identical paths last year, literally limping their way to just two wins apiece. They were picked either at the bottom or near the bottom of their respective conferences coming into this season. Just a lot of parallels that can be drawn here. So USD thinks they're heading in the right direction, but from your perspective, where are things at with the Aggies?
You know, I think the Aggies are going in the right direction, and you could see a lot of that in week one versus Nevada, of course, an FBS team, but we certainly put out a good effort, losing 31-17, but moved the ball, did some good things on defense, and I think what's different this year versus a year ago is we have a returning quarterback, and he's pretty good in Ben Scott. We've got some good wideouts who have got another year of experience, very veteran linebacking crew. So I kind of like where the Aggies are at in 2015.
Now, you mentioned that game against Nevada. Ben Scott threw it 47 times against the Wolfpack compared to just 27 attempts on the ground. The Aggies running for just 89 yards on the night. I'm sure that's a number they'd like to see go up, isn't it?
They still want to get the ground game established. I mean, Ron Gould, head coach, was 16 years a running back coach under Jeff Bedford at Cal. So, I mean, he's a running back guy. And, you know, part of the issue, we had a great running back in Gabe Manzanares who graduated last year. So still trying to figure out what that starting crew will look like in the backfield. But I think as Davis plays more FCS competition, you'll see that ground game established. And the 47 passes may be a little bit misleading because certainly a lot of those passes you mentioned, only, you know, 5 yards per catch, a lot of screen passes and a lot of, you know, passes that are really more runs than passes. So, I mean, Davis is always looking run first, get the back established, maybe go down the field occasionally. But it's a run-oriented offense, Jay.
Finally, Scott, Saturday's meeting between South Dakota and UC Davis will be the second in three seasons. The Coyotes edged the Aggies 10-7 in the 2013 season opener, which was actually pretty typical for how these teams have played each other in the past. So what kind of game are you anticipating this time around?
Well, more of the same, I think. I mean, how could you not, based on the history? You know, that last game was actually the first game in Coach Gould's coaching history at Davis, his first game as a head coach. And, you know, I think you saw a lot of week one things back then a couple of years ago with the Aggies. It'll be interesting. Both teams have a game under their belt. Obviously, playing up against tougher competition, this will be a more fair match for both sides. And, you know, I know that the Coyotes have had a lot of changes, too, since the last couple of years when we played them. So it'll be interesting to see what happens on the field. I think certainly Davis, it'll be a different team for you guys to look at from a couple of years ago. And there's no doubt that South Dakota will give us a different look as well.
All right. He is Scott Marsh, again, radio voice of UC Davis football for KHTK Radio in Sacramento. Now, the Aggies will host South Dakota this Saturday night. It'll be the sixth meeting all time and the fourth since 2009. It's tough to know whether or not it'll be low scoring once again, but history does indicate that it will be close. Of the previous five games between the two, four have been decided by 4 points or less. And if the Coyotes are going to come out on the right side of this one, Joe Glenn says there's one thing they have to do.
We got to go in there and get some wind in our sail. I would hope, and I'm sure they would hope, that we can run the ball, if not a lot, but effectively when we do run it. And we've got to get up over 4 yards a carry if we're going to win this game. And then we got to mix in the run and the pass. And I'm sure our offensive coaches will come up with a good game plan. We are healthy. Everybody's going to make the trip. We didn't lose anybody in the game with Kansas State, and that's a very big plus for us as well.
Kickoff at Aggie Stadium is slated for 8 p.m. Central Time, and I will be there, so be sure to check out midcosn.com for coverage of the road trip through the Coyote Corner video blog. You can also follow me on Twitter at ElsonMidcoSN for live updates throughout the game. Well, the University of South Dakota is on the leading edge of a new era in college athletics. We'll explain what that means for the student athlete when we come back.
Coyote Corner on Midco Sports Network is presented by Dakota Land Honda.
Welcome back. Last Friday, the University of South Dakota Department of Athletics made what had been widely speculated official when it announced the school would provide cost of attendance stipends to athletes in all 17 sports beginning in the 2016-17 school year. full cost of attendance includes academic-related supplies, transportation costs, and other incidentals, areas that weren't allowed by the NCAA to be included in scholarships prior to this academic year. USD Athletic Director David Herbster explains what went into the decision and what it means to the university's student-athletes.
Since the NCAA made the decision and changed the definition of what full cost of attendance and how that would equate to an athletic scholarship, it's been on probably the desk of every athletic director to evaluate this and determine, is that something that's viable for their own athletic program? It wasn't that long ago that we were sitting at 105 scholarships still in Division II, and we're now at 187 scholarships, and we made that investment in our student athletes. And we look at this new opportunity to provide the resources for our student athletes as our further commitment to those students and really for our willingness to compete and to win at this level.
Now, South Dakota joins North Dakota, North Dakota State, and Liberty University of Virginia as the only FCS schools in the country to offer full cost of attendance. While it may be too soon to tell what kind of advantage the extra scholarship will provide, the message that it sends to current and potential USD student athletes is clear.
Does it truly make a difference? Are you going to pull a prospective student athlete from one campus to another just because you're offering full cost of attendance? You know what? We've been getting some pretty darn good kids without it right now. But that being said, we know the landscape nationally is changing. If we want to be able to continue to compete at that level, we need to provide the opportunities that everybody else is providing.
USD values the benefits of full cost of attendance at a maximum of $4,145 per scholarship, just over $700 more than the max of UND and NDSU. All right, that is our time for this week. Remember, Coyotes in action Saturday night at UC Davis, kickoff at 8 p.m. Central. And we'll, of course, be back here next Tuesday night to break it all down for you on another episode of Coyote Corner.